taste when you broke the night with day. Hear our song, praise to our God, praise to our God, bringing honor to your majesty.
in my ear tells me there are feelings. He shares a melody, tells me to repeat it, and it makes me whole. He reminds my soul. Sing it out. I am all. And he says, I am his own. I was blinded by scales upon my eyes. Then he came in like a light, burn above the light. And he set me free. He reminded me, I am all. He says, I am all. He says, I'm free. I'm no slave to sin. And I'm a saint. I am righteousness. And I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive. Yeah. I'm alive. I'm alive. I'm alive. Let's sing it out. Let's sing it together. I'm all. He says, I am. I am all. He says, I am. I am all. He says, I am. I am all. He says, I am. And he says, I am his own.
Scripture with you. Before we look at our text for the day, I want to share this with you. This is about what this song says. In Romans, there's this beautiful scripture, and you can agree with me verbally or clapping or grunting, whatever, but I want to read truth to you today. So practice something. Okay, that me. It says, what shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Isn't that good news? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect children, his church, the called out ones? It is God who justifies. Who can condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who right now is praying for us. Right now, Christ is praying for us. You by name. He knows your freckles. He knows the side of the bed you sleep on. He knows which tooth you brush better than the others. Amen. He is praying for you, says the dentist in the house. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. This is who we are. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of Christ Jesus. Amen? That's who he says that you are. You're free this morning. If you're a Christ follower, you are forgiven. You are right with God. Amen?
Amen.
If you're not a Christ follower, you're being invited and called and beckoned and romanced and wooed by the King of the universe to be right with him. You're being called this relationship of love. It's not rules. It's not regulations. It's a God who desperately knows that you need him, that he is the best thing for you, that he is the salve for all of your wounds. He is the peace for all chaos. The one that sleeps through the storms, Jesus, looks at you today and says, I love you more than you can imagine, more than you know. Our hero today is this guy Abraham. And God called him out of this crazy life that didn't honor God. He called him and he said this, if you'll follow me, I'll bless you seven ways. I want to tell you today, God still blesses those that he calls, and God still calls. Wherever you are, God's calling you to walk in, to enjoy him, to walk with him, and to enjoy this love that is better than anything else you know. As we sing this, just sing to the one that loves you. Good, weak, bad, it doesn't matter. Just sing and give your heart to him. If you don't know Christ, I say this to you today. Ask God to speak to you right now, because he can. He's phenomenal at getting in the darkness and speaking to us.
Jealous. By glory.
Jamie and I had the opportunity to go out to a conference this last weekend, and we missed you guys. We were in Vegas. Dr. McQueen that spoke told you guys that. I had a friend ask me, how many pastoral conferences are there in Vegas? I said, not many. This wasn't a pastoral conference. It was a how to sell on Amazon. But we missed you guys, and glad that you're here, and glad we could be here this morning. It's not the same not being here. The money. I got the 20. I didn't put it on black. I don't know how roulette really works. I don't know if you heard that story or not. I'll tell it to you real quick. Jamie and I are on the plane. It's a direct flight from Atlanta to Vegas. And this guy sits beside me, and he's probably 60, 65, I don't know. And we're talking. Well, he asked me, he goes, are you traveling alone? I said, no, I'm traveling with my wife. He said, my wife's up there, and I want her to sit by me. He was trying to get me to switch seats with him. And I said, well, you know, like, I'm not going to do that. You know, my wife's right here, and I like her more than your wife, so I'm going to keep my wife here. And so, anyway, so he starts talking, and the dude's language is, like, all over the place. And so what do you do? And he goes, you know, I own a bunch of bars, which that's fine. You know, no big deal about that. And he's dropping the F-bomb, and he's a crass old dude. And he goes, what are you doing? And for fun, I didn't tell him about the preacher part. I was like, I'm an entrepreneur. I have an e-commerce business. He goes, that's awesome. That's effing awesome. You know, he's just going. I'm like, he goes, what else do you do? I was like, I'm helping build a church. He goes, and it literally, like, spine changes. He sits up, and his whole and people do that. And sometimes I don't tell them that, because I'd rather them be honest than be fake. And so all that to be said, this guy's name is Vince. It's Vince Zeronian here. And Vince, it's funny. So I've got two crazy Vince friends now, Terry, not just one. And so he's talking to me, and at some point, he says, well, I want to go to heaven. And I said, well, that's good. You know, me too. And before I could tell him how we can go to heaven, he goes, so I need you to put 20 on black for your church. And he gives me a $20 bill. And I was like, well, that's not exactly how it works at all, you know, in any sense, form, or fashion. And so we talked about the Lord a little bit, and he still wanted me to put 20 on black. And so instead of wasting his 20 on black, I figured I'd bring 20 to Catalyst. So that's Vince that we met in the airport. He talked to me the whole time. Every time I'd start to doze off, he'd go, am I boring you? He'd slap me across the aisle and wake me up and keep talking to me for 4 hours. So I think I'm going to go to heaven because I talked to Vince for 4 hours. No, I don't think that's why people go to heaven. But anyway, we had this opportunity to go. Vegas is not like Montgomery or Prattville or Millbrook, in case you've never been there before. It's a pretty interesting place. The hotel we stayed at had 4,000 rooms in it. Pretty big place. a lot of bad stuff advertised. They don't really hide bad stuff. We hide bad stuff here. They advertise it and give you catchy phone numbers for it there. That's a big difference. But we just wanted you to know we're glad to be home. And this morning we're talking about these unlikely heroes. I want to tell you a story. How many of you guys have ever seen tightrope walkers? Anybody ever seen a tightrope walker before? In the 1800s, there was this guy named Blondin. It was his nickname. And he had seen circuses as a child. This is like 1850s. And he decided he wanted to cross over the most dangerous, perilous place he could find. So he decided to cross over Niagara Falls. Anybody ever been to Niagara Falls? It sits up in the corner where New York and Canada kind of meet. And Shannon, would you imagine walking across over the tightrope? Not ever. This dude did it, and he advertised it to all these papers. Papers started making fun of him. The New York Times said he was a fool, should be arrested. But they all had reporters there. I think basically everybody wanted to see him fall to his death. They wanted to have, like, proof of it, like we were there, we saw it. So the dude set up this tightrope across Niagara Falls. The rope was 3 inches thick, and it spanned over 1,000 feet. Now, you're going, how far is that? Think of walking a tightrope over one of the highest waterfalls in the world for 3 football fields. It was so far that it dropped 60 feet in elevation. And I want you to think, I mean, like, I do not like heights. Wes, we're in Vegas. Wes did not want to do anything with heights. Have a roller coaster that sits on the side of a building. I think at some point you go, Wes is like, no, he wouldn't do anything with it. How many of y'all just hate heights? Anybody? How many people just love heights? Matt, I love being near death. Okay, that's some of you guys. Chris Carley likes that. So this dude is, he's on top of the waterfall. It's 1,000 feet across, 60 feet dip on a 3-inch rope. He started going across this thing. At some point, he stopped and laid down on it. It was so far. And another point, it was 17 minutes across. His feet started getting tired. He went all the way across, 17 minutes. He got over to the other side. Everybody cheered. And then he said this, would anybody like to be my volunteer? How many volunteers do you think he had? None. Eventually, after he did this multiple times, he did it, taking things across. One time he took a wheelbarrow across. He took a wheelbarrow with bricks in it across. At some point, his manager, with a top hat, crawled on his back, and Blondin took his, this is 1859, took his manager all the way across the 17-minute, 1,000-foot trek and back to prove it could be done. Now, this morning we're talking about faith, right? Faith has got to be practical at some level. I don't have faith in Blondin. Would any of y'all have faith in Blondin? Would you have done that? I would not have done that. I don't care if I've seen him do it 1,000 times. He's never done it with me on his back, so that's the difference between him doing it and him doing it with me. This morning, we're talking about this idea that faith at some point has got to be something real in your life. Like in most people who would say they follow Jesus, their faith is this idea. It's like, yeah, I have faith. I'm a Christ follower, but it never, ever really hits the road of their life. It never becomes real in their life. And today we're going to talk about this idea of there's really 2 ways you can live your life. Number one, you can live your life by sight. And that's empirical. What you see is what you understand. How many guys would say you lean toward that? I think most would say that. I see it, I hear it, I can touch it, I believe it. If you come from a science background or a math background, that's kind of how a lot of times you'll lean. And the other side is you live by faith in what you can't see. And the challenge for us as believers is we can't see God. Anybody ever just personally seen God? If you have, I'd like to talk to you afterwards and you tell me about it. We haven't actually ever seen Jesus Christ. I've never seen heaven. I've read books about heaven, that little movie about the kid that says heaven's for real. You know, whether your opinion is, he saw heaven, supposedly. I've never seen heaven. I believe in heaven. I've never seen hell. Anybody ever seen hell? No. Anybody ever seen the Holy Spirit? I've never met anybody that wrote the Bible personally, but I believe it. I've never seen the Holy Spirit personally, but I believe in the Holy Spirit. So for us, we've got this challenge of how do we live lives of faith even though we've never seen these things? And that's a big challenge. And we would say that we trust in God, we believe in God, but there are times when God doesn't seem evident, right? God doesn't seem apparent. God doesn't seem in our sight, in our touch, in our taste, and he seems distant. And it's that moment you have these crises of faith. Our hero today is this guy named Abraham, and Abraham is the Mac Daddy of faith in the Bible. If we've been studying Noah. Dr. McQuinn did a great job last week. Give him a hand, by the way. He may watch the video this week. But he did a great job. Mike is an ENT surgeon. He's like, tell him I don't preach all the time. Like, you did a great job. I watched it. You guys did great, you know, listening and interacting with him. But Noah had a moment of faith. Abraham had this pattern, this life of faith. In the whole Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, anybody that's a person of faith, they're called a child of Abraham. All over the place in the Bible, it explains, even during prayers and saying, God, give us faith. A lot of times they'll say, give us faith of our father Abraham. You know, Abraham is this model, this example of people of faith. Abraham was a real dude, by the way. He wasn't fairy tales. He was a real person. The place you grew up is southern Iraq right now. I have a friend that was in the Air Force and was stationed in Iraq, and his commanding general was a real strong Christian. He goes, hey, we're going to go do some maneuvers in ancient city of Ur. And Brad was like, ancient city of Ur, that's where Abraham's from. The general's like, yeah, we're going to go see Abraham's house because I want to go there. And so our tax money, praise Jesus, paid for them to go to see. They know where Abraham grew up. Abraham's, the town he was in was an advanced culture. They had a lot of, they had these minarets that examples different gods. They worshiped different gods. Had all these different things going on. They had advanced math. They were a scientific community. But we also know this. We know that it was a horribly paganistic people. They worshiped nature and they worshiped different things. We know from archaeology that they have found people that were sacrificed in the tombs of their rulers. In other words, the place that Abraham grew up, they made human sacrifices during funerals to people. Pretty bad place. So this wasn't like he grew up in Sunday school. Okay? It wasn't like he grew up in Enterprise, Alabama or Millbrook or wherever. He grew up in a bad, bad place. We know at some point in time that God revealed himself to him. At some point in time, God started speaking to him. We don't have a whole lot of record of how that was, but we know he did because we have all the proof of what happened afterwards. I want to share our definition of faith, and this is going to kind of set the backdrop for you. We say that faith is choosing to trust God in spite of your circumstances. Faith is when you and I choose to trust God in spite of our circumstances. That means things can be bad, and you can say, I have faith. I trust that God's going to get me through this thing. Faith isn't just faith. It's not just an idea. It's something that's paired with action. So here's the scripture that sets up for today. In Genesis 12, this is God speaking to Abraham. Abraham, his original name was Abram. And all through the Bible, we have these pictures of God interacting with people, and he'd give them a new identity. It's the same thing for us. That song says, I am all that he says I am. In Scripture, it says, if you're in Christ, if a person's a Christ follower, they're a new creation. The old things have passed, the new things have come. It even says in the Bible that God has given us a name that he knows. I believe in the end that God will call all of our names our unique names, and it'll be just between us and him. When I was in college, I was in fraternity. I'm a child of the 70s, the name Matthew. How many of y'all have friends that are about in their 30s named Matthew? Everybody has people named Matthew. In my fraternity, there were like 12 guys named Matthew. You'd say Matt and 20 of us, or 12 of us, turn our heads and look. This is not how it is with God. God has a specific thing. He knows you. He knows where you are. And God gives people new names. So Abram's one of these things. So in Genesis 12, the Lord said to Abram, same guy as Abraham, original name, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you. Verse 2, and I will make you a great nation. I will bless you, and I'll make your name great so that you will be a blessing. Verse 3, I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So God offers Abraham, I call it a divine opportunity. I think Abraham was like the original entrepreneur. If you'll do this, then I will do this. Here's what God did. God says, if you obey me, and he gives him seven promises. Number one, I'll make you a great nation. Now, you need to understand this. Abram, at this point, is an old dude with no children. Okay, he's not talking about the idea you can be elected to be a leader of a great nation. He is basically saying, if you'll obey me, I will make you, your lineage, your family, into a great nation. Does that seem likely for an old dude? I don't think it's likely at all. Okay, second promise. I will bless you. How many guys would love to have a benefactor that's the most wealthy person on the planet to say, I'll bless you? If you're that person, I would love for you to benefact. I would love that. I'd love for you to go, Matt, I will bless you. God says to Abram, if you obey me, I'll bless you. This is an all-encompassing blessing. He doesn't say, I'll just bless your work. He says, I will bless you. Anybody ever had somebody that really was a blessing in their life? You smile seeing them coming, right? You ever had a generous friend? You ever had a friend that they never let you buy lunch? You ever had that friend? How many times you turn down a lunch invite from them? Sure, I'll go. That'd be awesome because you're going to bless me. Same thing. I'll bless you. Number three, I will make you famous. I'll give you a great name. Number four, you will be a blessing. So not only am I going to bless you, I'll make it where you're a blessing. Number five, I'll bless your friends. That's a good thing, isn't it? Number six, I will curse your enemies. All these things are hinging on whether he obeys God. God says, if you obey me, I'll do all these things. And the last thing says, you'll bless all of mankind through you. What we know from Abraham, the lineage of Christ, the direct bloodline is Jesus comes from Abraham. We know that. So what he's saying is there's ultimately going to be a blessing. It's going to come through you for all of mankind if you'll simply obey me. So what's the most important thing for Abraham? To decide to what? To obey. Everything hinges on this moment. This is Genesis 12. There's 12, 13 chapters in Genesis about this guy, Abraham, what he does, where he goes. He's not a perfect guy. He makes mistakes. He goes into Egypt, lies about it. His wife, Sarah, was obviously pretty good looking. He lies about it and says she was a sister, and that gets him in all kinds of trouble. He's not a perfect guy, but the pattern of his life is a life that trusts and has faith in God. Over and over again, you know the story of Isaac when God asked him to make a sacrifice. This is a picture of Jesus for us. And he says, I will sacrifice. This is the promised son. We know all these things about Abraham that he trusted God. He believed God, not when it was easy, but he believed God even when it was tough. The scripture for today is from Hebrews 11. We told you the last few weeks, Hebrews is this book in the New Testament written to people who were Jewish. They were Hebrew. Okay, that's why it says Hebrews. The title of the book means a lot. Hebrews is a book written with this perspective of people that understand Jewish culture. It's all about the sacrifices and all about the temple and all about the high priest and all these things that are really foreign to us unless you're Jewish. If you're Jewish, the book of Hebrews makes total sense. It'd be like God saying, I want to reach out to Americans. So he would write about the things that we know, the things that would speak to us and make sense to us. Hebrews is this book to these Jewish folks. And in Hebrews 11, there are five verses we're going to look at today about how Abraham and his wife Sarah acted. And we're going to learn from these things how we should act, how we can have faith, how we can be people that say, you know what, I'm going to trust God even when things are tough. Would y'all say that in the last month you've had a moment where you had a choice, an option to trust God or not? Anybody been there with us? We've all been there. You know, growing up, Blair had had a little bumper sticker on his mirror in his bathroom. I think it was like a reminder to him, and it says, faith isn't faith until it's all you're holding on to. Think about that. Faith isn't faith until it's all you're holding on to. We all love to say, I'm a faithful person, but when life gets tough, what do you trust? You know, some of y'all are on my email list, but our dad right now is in one of these situations where we've got to have faith right now. My father's got cancer. He's got a tumor on his left kidney. It's 4 inches. The doctors, we said, is, you know, what are the prognosis? And they're like, if you don't have surgery, you need to say goodbye. It's not going to be real long. It's one of those things that's going to spread. We know it spreads. It's what it does. And as a family, my dad's got a weak heart from some congestive heart failure stuff. As a family, we're believing Scripture. We're praying Scripture. We're saying that God's greater than this, that God's going to get glory from this, that there are people that are talking and praying about the Lord that haven't been talking otherwise. It's a way we can witness. It's a way we can keep our chin up, a way we can example when life is tough. How do people that honor Jesus live? We believe this is kind of an odd opportunity for us as a family. Faith isn't faith until it matters. And for you and for me, we can learn from Abraham because there were things he went through that we can look at him, we can look at how he lived, and we can go this. Life wasn't always easy for him, but he honored God, he trusted God, he believed God, to the point that the whole Bible says that he was the father of those who are faithful. And the New Testament says that Abraham believed God, and God credited to him as righteousness. You go, what does that mean? That means this, that there's an account somewhere. The Bible says that we're going to give an account for our lives. There's an account, and we've got to be righteous. And you and I, the Bible says we're not righteous. But we're righteous by trusting in Christ. Well, Abraham, Christ wasn't here yet. So he was believing in the idea that God was going to take care of him. He believed all that he knew of God. He was looking forward to this Messiah. He didn't have the Old Testament, the New Testament, the prophecies. He had an idea what God was going to do, and he trusted all that he knew of himself to all that he knew of God. He trusted all that he could. And God says, I see that you trust me. I'm going to credit you with being righteous. The Bible also says because Abraham believed, he was a friend of God. Now, we take friendship lightly because of Facebook. I have 2,000. How many Facebook friends does Russia Fools have, Wes? 100,000. Now, this is kind of an ingest kind of thing. If y'all had if your van blew up and your engine had slung rods, you're like, we need $10,000 to rebuild that. Do you think if you put on Facebook, hey, 100,000 fans, I need $10,000 this today. Who will meet me at I-85? Do you think 10,000 people will show up? You would like to think so. What's the reality? They're not. That's not friends. That's a lower down definition of what friends are. in the Bible, friends are friends. I got an email. My friend Jewin from India is praying for my dad. And in their culture, they have this thing called their sati. It's your one and only best friend. Like, I see girls sign things like BFF, and they have like 20 BFFs. By definition, 20 people can't be your BFF. Just, you can't be your best friend forever. It can't be your best. You can be one of my best friends forever, but you can't be my best. It just makes me crazy. But in their culture, they have one. That's their sati. And Juwan will call Jeff, our friend, his sati. That's my one and only best friend. That's the one person that I call in all of my life and all of this world and all my experiences, my best friend. And God says about Abraham, because you believe me, you are my friend. For you today and for me today, God calls us into that kind of relationship. I'm going to read you these verses we're going to talk about. Number one, in verse 8, it says, by faith, this is this idea of trusting, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. Okay, so here's the idea number one. When God called, Abraham was a hero because when God called, he obeyed and acted. Now, growing up, how many of you got in trouble because your parents asked you to do something and you would put it off? Anybody besides me? Okay, there's always an understood now. Right? Clean your room. Well, I was going to get around to it. In our house, we would have a list of chores, and I would always say, hey, when do these have to be done by? I would. 5 o'clock today, I'd be like, okay. And it would make my mom crazy, because I'd be hanging out watching Scooby-Doo or He-Man or whatever on TV. You know, it's 3 o'clock. I got 2 more hours. I can watch another episode of the Brady Bunch. And then 3:30, and she's like, and she's getting mad. I'm like, nuh-uh, you said I had 2 of 5. And then about 4:40, you go into a frenzy, right? You're cleaning and dusting and vacuuming, all that kind of stuff. We all like to put things off. And Abraham obeyed. I don't want to bore you with Greek, but there's something important to know in this. In the Greek sentence of this, the verb basically says, as he was being called, Abraham was obeying. And it means this. The idea is God wasn't finished with the sentence before Abraham moved. Think about that real quick. Don't just pass that. Before God even finished the sentence, Abraham, go from this land to a land I will show you, Abraham was up and moving. How many parents would love to have your children obey like that? Megan's like, hey, that's not our nature. There was something in Abraham. When God called him, he changed. When God called him, he said this, I'm going to obey you and I'm going to act on you because I believe that you are who you say you are. Number two, in verse 9, by faith, he went to live in the land of promise as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. The second thing is Abraham chose to patiently believe. God made promises to Abraham that you will have be a great nation, all these things. Here's what's interesting about Abraham. None of those promises came true in his lifetime. Anybody know how much land Abraham owned before he died? Anybody? It's interesting. He owned one little piece of land. That's where he buried his wife. He wasn't a great nation yet. He didn't have fortune yet. But God made these promises about him. What if you and I, what if God made promises about us and our families, and we started moving toward it, and it was really for our kids or our grandkids? Would any of y'all like for your kids and grandkids to have a better life than you've had? A more Christ-honoring life, a more prosperous life, in every sense of the word, not just money. Abraham believed this. Abraham had enough vision to say, you know what? I know I'm old and God says I'm going to have children. Both Abraham and Sarah, by the way, when God said they're going to have kids, at some point they both laughed. They both laughed. He was like 99, she was 90. She was old, he was old. But he chose to patiently believe. Sometimes there may be things today that you're trying to move toward. There may be promises of God that you haven't seen come true yet. Anybody there? Some of you may have a wayward child that you're praying for. Some of you today are going, Matt, I feel like God is there, but sometimes he's not. I'm praying these promises, but I'm not seeing them come true. Follow the example of Abraham. There are all these wonderful things. It says he lived in tents. And I've always read this thinking, everybody lived in tents. Everybody didn't live in tents. People had homes. They had not like our homes, but they had permanent structures. He lived in a tent because that wasn't his homeland yet. God had promised it to him, but it wasn't his. It wasn't his inheritance. Yeah, it came later on because of his obedience. It'd be like me saying, Stephen Scott, I own all of America. I give you Texas. Now get an RV, go to Texas, and I'm going to mail you the deed. And when the deed's there, you can become king of Texas. Do whatever you want to with Texas, all the oil, all the mineral rights, you're the king of Texas. And Stephen moves to Texas, and he goes to a to an RV camp, and he's set up, and he's, you know, I'm not set up long. This isn't my home. I'm king of Texas. And everybody's like, okay, Stephen, king of Texas, okay. And you're like, make me ribs. I'm king of Texas, and bring me your oil and your rich, you know, richness. Bring it to me. And everybody's like, okay, you've been here a week. You need to move on. And so Stephen's like, I'm moving on, but I'm still king of Texas. And you go to the next RV park, and you stay there, and you grill out, and you're telling everybody, I'm king. Everybody's like, okay, crazy dentist man from Alabama, you're a king, but just move on. And your whole life, you know what's rightfully yours, but it's never yours. How frustrated would Abraham have been? I'd have been lit up mad. What we don't see is the intense conversations between Abraham and God. But God, you promised. You see all through, if we had a lot of time to study in Genesis, you see where God reminds Abraham from time to time, hey, I still got this covenant with you. I'm still, things that still come true. The stuff on the news right now about Israel and Palestine, all that stuff, that's this story, guys. That's this story. This is not old news. This is current events. Just happens to be written, you know, a couple thousand years ago. He was patiently believing God. He knew the promises would come true, but he just hadn't seen them come true yet. For some of you, it may be that you're praying for a person that's far from God to come back to God. You may not see it happen right now. For some of you, it may be that you feel like that God has failed you. It may be that you've got somebody in your family that's turned their back on God, and you're going to God, I just trust you. I just believe you. I'm still praying. If you don't give up your faith. Follow Abraham. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't stop. The reason we play Don't Stop Believing is for that. I know it's a stretch, but it's awesome. We wanted to play that this morning. We don't want you to stop. We want you to keep on believing, because if our life, if we believed it 1 second and it automatically happened, that doesn't take much faith to believe that. You know what's wonderful when you believe something for a long time and it comes true? Isn't that wonderful when you prayed for something over and over again? When it's been on your prayer list for over and over again, you pray that somebody would come to Jesus and they eventually do. Or you go, I've invited them to church 50 times, they don't come. We'll invite them 51 times. I've shared the gospel with my coworker. I've tried to be encouraged. I've taken them to lunch. Keep on shining. Keep on being who you're supposed to be. Because sometimes it takes a saturation point. There's a study done by a guy named D. James Kennedy that says that before people come to Christ, they need 13 instances of the gospel in their life. That may mean if you know somebody that's not a believer that doesn't follow Jesus, that maybe you're number 6 in the list of 13. That's on average. There might be a person who comes on the second invitation to church or to God. So it might take another person 25 times. But what if it takes 25 times and we give up at 20? Wouldn't you rather be at the 25th? Wouldn't you rather be faithful? And it doesn't always happen 25 from the same person. See, Chris Curley might invite somebody to church, and he's number 20, and then I'm number 21, and I invite him, and then Vince or Terry invites him, number 22, and you see how it works. And then maybe at 25, somebody invites him, and they actually come. It's all this thing together. I would just say, be like Abraham. Don't stop believing. Keep on trusting. Keep on having faith. Patiently believe what God's going to do. Jamie and I had a friend that was praying for children all the time, and they miscarried a bunch of times. They went to fertility clinics, all this crazy stuff, and they couldn't get pregnant. And the lady, I've told the story before, was sitting behind me at a Mother's Day service, and she's crying her eyes out about babies, and I just want a baby. I want to be a good mom. And she's like, and all these stupid teenagers, they look at each other wrong, and they get pregnant, and I can't even, me and my husband are doing everything right, and we can't get pregnant. She's just bawling her eyes out, and the Lord told me to tell her, you will have babies. You'll have babies. And I'm like, God, if that's wrong, I'm the biggest jerk in the world. You don't tell a mama she's going to have babies. She can't have babies. And God's like, tell her. And I looked over, and her name was Maxie. I said, Maxie, you're going to have babies. I don't know why God told me, but you're going to have babies. I hope I'm right. I believe I'm right. I hope I'm right. And I told her, and a year later, she calls me and says, Madam, we're pregnant. I'm like, yeah, you're pregnant. God told me we're going to be pregnant. And so they have a baby, little baby Ruth. We called her Baby Ruth, candy bar thing. And her name was Ruth. And then, like, a year and a half later, she called. Guess what? Pregnant again. What's the second baby's name? Baby Rose. And then, like, a year or two later, she calls me back. Hey, guess what? We have another baby. 3 girls. Well, then I got a fourth call about 5 years into this. She goes, guess what? Weirdest conversation Todd and I've ever had before. I'm like, what? I'm like, you have another baby? She goes, no, he's going to get a vasectomy. You know? And she was so thrilled because they couldn't have babies. And now they were having to have preventative surgery because they were so stinking good at having babies. And that's what God does. God honors faith. God gets a lot of credit out of that. If Maxie had said, you know, the first time we started having babies, I had a baby, I wouldn't be telling her story today. There's nothing phenomenal about that. There's nothing gracious about that. That's not the story of I was far from God and God changed my life and healed my life. Abraham had a story. He was from a really, really bad place. He had a before and an after, but his after was full of faith, believing God, trusting God, that God could do great things through him. I would just encourage you today, patiently believe that God's going to do what he said he's going to do for you. Let's keep going. Next verse. I lost my scripture here. In verse 10, it says, "For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God." That's a fancy way of saying he's looking forward to heaven. See, Abraham had a small picture of who God was. He didn't have the picture. He didn't have all of Scripture. I would love to know, what did God tell you for you to believe him like you did? It had to be something good. It says he saw the glory of God. I don't know if it was a vision. I don't know if God's an angel, but I know this. Abraham saw enough of God to say this, "I will pattern my whole life after you." So here's the third thing about Abraham. Number three is he leaned into God's promises. The reason he's a hero to me is he leaned into God's promises. He didn't say, "These things may come true." You ever watch people's body language? Jamie and I go out to eat and we'll watch couples, and you'll see like a young guy over there, like he's like talking like this, and if the girl's leaning back and her arms are crossed, I'm like, "Run away. She is not going to respond to you." And then you'll see this young couple, they're like, and they're both leaning in and they're talking. Jamie and I, we started dating. We had a friend named, a doctor named Dr. Rick, and he was our friend. And we were on one of our first dates at a place called Jalapenos here in Montgomery. And we're sitting there talking, and he and his wife came up, and I don't remember this, but we prayed a blessing, and he's like this hopeless romantic. He said, "And when y'all said amen, you didn't want to let go of your hands." I don't remember this. I don't remember a lot of things, but he said we just kind of lingered like, "Oh, it's so wonderful to hold your hand," you know, whatever. And he said, "I knew from that day that y'all were for each other because you were leaning into each other." I don't know if that's true or not, that's why he knew. But I know this, when you want something, you lean in toward it. You're eager for it, right? You don't separate yourself from it. I see in Abraham this guy that said this, "I don't understand all the promises, but I lean in toward them. I lean in toward them." You know, for you and for me, there are times when God's going, "Are you leaning in toward me or are you leaning away from me? Are you going to trust me? Are you going to trust the things I've said, or are you going to lean away from them?" The next thing, verse 11, says, "By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age." She was old. She's an old woman. "Since she considered him faithful who had promised." The number four things about Sarah, she was a hero because she knew the faithful promiser. See, for us to believe God's promises, you got to know him. Like, there are people in my life that they said, "Matt, I will do anything you need for me." Okay. I believe that. I've got some people I believe that for. There are other people that said, "I'm going to buy you a Coke next Tuesday." Whatever, dude, you're a loser. You're not going to do that. There are people that I know I can trust and people I know I can't trust. She knew God enough to know this. If he promised it, it'll come true. If he promised it, it'll come true. And just look at your own faith. Are you there? If God says he'll do it, will he do it? You know, Brian Bass and I had lunch a couple months ago, Brian. And we're talking about Catalyst and how Catalyst is growing. And you said something cool that day. You said, "I want to kind of get on the ground level so I can know some folks before Catalyst gets real big." And I said, "You know what? I got the same heart too. I believe that. I believe there are a lot of people that need to be here that aren't here yet. I believe that. Like, I will not be surprised when there are 2 and 3 services on a Sunday morning here. I'll be thankful and I'll be crying and clapping and whatever. I will not be surprised a bit when that happens because I see that. Like, don't make me think I'm spooky or crazy. I see these empty seats filled. I do. I see people volunteering for children, volunteering for preschool, volunteering for greeting. I see all those needs taken care of because God's told me that's going to happen. It doesn't matter if I see it or not. I believe him. I believe he's been faithful in the past. I have a list. I have in my journal, I have a God is sovereign in Matt's life list. All the ways that God has shown up in my life. Before Jamie and I even met, before Jamie was born, her daddy's daddy, was on staff at a church in Panama City in the 50s with a man named Andrew Smith. Andrew Smith later on became real good friends of my family. Andrew and Jamie's granddaddy were best buddies on staff of this church. Andrew actually baptized my father-in-law. Years later, there's a little girl named Jamie Jernigan. She's born in Florida, and my wife, and she goes to school, does really well in school. And long story short, gets a scholarship to go to a private school in Montgomery. She was going to go to Florida. She'd have been a junior in Florida. First day of class, they had to pay her to go to school, but God told her for some reason not to go to school there. Jamie is smart. She doesn't just like going to things. She doesn't have to, but she felt God leading her to Montgomery. She calls her friend Andrew. who lives in Montgomery and says, hey, I want to go to a church. Where do I need to go to church? Andrew brings her to the church I was serving. We met that day. I believe that God was lining up me and Jamie to be together before we were even born. That's how sovereign God is. People say, God only answers things you pray. That's silly. God does all kinds of things because God is God. God does whatever God wants to do. That's part of being God. It's the 00 God card. I can do whatever I want to. I'm God. And it's right because I'm God. I can do it. Sarah knew that God was this way, and she said this, I can trust him because he's God. Let's keep going. Verse 12. Therefore, from one man Abraham, and him as good as dead, were born descendants as many as the stars of heaven and as many as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. So the fifth thing is Abraham was a hero because he obeyed God and God magnified his life. For you and I, we can say this. Life can be our story or life can be God's story and God can make a whole lot of out of our lives. It's just what are we going to let him do? There was nothing really substantial about Abraham. In Joshua, it says that Abram then was a pagan just like the rest of them. He worshipped false gods. He did all that stuff. We don't know what all he did, but we know this. He wasn't automatically a God follower. There was a moment where he interacted with God, and God said, will you obey me? Here's what I believe. I believe if Abram had said no, then we would never have known his name. I think God would have found somebody else. Y'all believe that? I believe that because God's purposes will stand. God's going to do what he wants to do. I've seen in my life the times I didn't obey God, that God says, okay, and I'll do something else. In high school, I have a first cousin named Rob, who has a very different background than I have. And Rob was kind of a rebellious teenager, got into a lot of stuff. I did not. I was in church, and my sin was secret. His sin was public. Let's put it that way. And God, about my 10th grade year, God said to me, you need to reach out to your cousin. We didn't do anything together. We were far from each other. And I just said, no, God, we don't have the same friends. He's not like me. He'll ridicule me. And over again, anytime I'd pray, God would say, you need to reach out to your cousin Rob. And I'd say, no, he's far from God. He's not going to do anything. And 10th grade, 11th grade, my 12th grade year, went through high school. Rob still rebelling, doing all his stuff. A month after our high school graduation, a friend of mine's a youth pastor, took a trip to Colorado. And he called me 2 days before the trip. And he said, hey, by the way, our worship leader for the trip just got sick and can't go. I'll pay for you to go to Colorado. You go with us. Well, what do you say to that? Yes, I'm 18. I have nothing going on. Paid trip to Colorado. So I go, and Rob, for some reason, went on this trip. What I didn't know is about a month before the trip, my cousin Rob had gotten his life right with Christ. And on the trip, Rob is like this. He's leading people to Jesus. He's sharing his story. He's doing all these cool things. And one night, Rob was sharing a testimony, and the Lord spoke to me and said this. This should be your fruit to benefit, but it wasn't because you didn't let me use you. But I did what I was going to do. Now, you get to see it, but it could have been your blessing, and it's somebody else's blessing. God's going to do what God's going to do. Do y'all agree with that? I think Abraham had an option to be used by God, and he said yes. For us, I want us to be, let God use us and be used. So here, if Abraham and Sarah came today, here's what I think they'd say to us. I think they would say, they'd ask us five questions. Number one, do you obey and act when God calls? Just ask yourself that question. Maybe scale of 1 to 10, do I obey and act when God calls? Just think about that for a minute. God calls us to do weird things. For Abram, it was to leave your land, leave your father's household, and go to a land I will show you. It's like the unknown road trip. Is that crazy to you? In college, I had some fraternity brothers who took a quarter. Every time they came to a major intersection, they flipped it. Heads for left, tails for right. 9.5 hours later, they got to Panama City from Troy. That's not really how long it takes. It's usually about a 3-hour trip. They got like 100 miles out. Oh, no, we got to go left, you know. God called them to a place, Abraham, to a place he didn't know. When God calls you, do you obey? Just think about that. That's hard. When God calls you, obey. Number two question, what promise of God are you waiting on? You ever been there? What does God promise? Now, some of you would say, man, I don't even know the promises of God. Well, you need to read your Bible. You need to start figuring out, how do I find the promises of God? If I had a rich benefactor that says, Matt, I'll give you all these things, but it's contained in a book, you just got to read the book. I'd read the book. I'd find out a way to read the book. Okay, number three. Do you lean into the things of God? Ask yourself, do you lean into the things of God? Things of God are like us hanging out together as a group, us when you have a chance to be involved in a Bible study, or somebody praying for you, or when you're struggling. Leaning in means I want to share that struggle with another person who loves God so they can help me with it. Leaning away means I'll just keep it to myself. Do you lean into the things of God or do you lean away from them? Number four, do you have a relationship with the promiser? You are never going to do hard things for God until you know who he is. How many of y'all, when your husband or wife calls, you have to ask them to identify themselves? This is who? Jamie, who? You work at AU? What department do you work in? Seventh floor? What color is your hair? No, I know Jamie's voice. I know who she is. I know we don't ever say, hey, hello, Jamie, this is Matt. Matt Andrus. I live at 133 Lakeshore, right beside you. I sleep on the other side of the bed. No, we don't do that because we know each other's voice. There are times, yesterday, I met a guy in public, and at some point he told me that his wife, he and his wife had separated yesterday. Yesterday. You know what God said to me? Invite him to church right now. You know what I did? Hey, Michael, man, it sounds like you need a place to encourage you. And I pulled out a card. We meet at AUM at 10:30 on Sunday mornings. And he kind of looked at me for a minute like, what are you doing? He needed to be here. He said he's going to be here. He's not here. But he said he's going to be here. God told me to invite him. We've got to be at a place when God says to do it, we do it. That's not big. That's easy. But there are going to be times when things are harder. When God asks, do you obey? Do you know the promiser? If you don't know him, you're going to think his promises are crazy. When God says things like, if you'll tithe, I'll take care of you. What? You want me to give my money? You're going to take care of me? Uh-uh. Well, if you know him, you know he will. But if you don't, you won't think he will. So you have a relationship with the promiser. And the last question, the question for today is, are you available for God to use you? Are you available for God to use you? Are you at a place where if God says, I want you to do this, that you'll respond and obey? Because I believe God will find people who will obey him. God's not going to be thwarted by us. People say, God's trying to do something. God doesn't try to do anything. God does whatever he wants to do. It's being God. It's being sovereign. But I believe in my life, I don't want God to ever look past me. I don't want God to go, I was looking for somebody to plant a church in Montgomery, but you wouldn't be faithful. I want to be the one that says, pick me, pick me, pick me. I may be the best one, but I'll be the most eager. Pick me. I want to be the one. I want to be the one. For you, are you available for God to use you? A few verses before we leave. In Hebrews 11, before this, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe. This is the believing from the heart that God exists and that he rewards those who seek him. In Ephesians 2, it says, for by grace you have been saved. Here it is. Through faith. This belief thing is huge to God. We find grace by believing in God. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. In John 17, it says, and this is eternal life, that they know you, that they believe in you, that they have faith in you, the only God, and Jesus Christ, in whom you've sent. This is all belief. This is all us trusting God. And in Romans 10, it says this, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart, says this faith thing, that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes, belief starts in your heart and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses. Here's how God works this. God starts stirring up inside of you this call to believe. For Abraham, God was calling him, knocking on the heart's door. I want you to believe in me. Many of you would say this, Matt, I was not even following God and God started moving. Many of y'all be that way? I did not want to know God when God started moving in my life. I want to be far from God. As a little kid, I understood that God, I really felt God was going to call me to something. I did not want to follow God. I remember Blair, I was about 10 years old, coming in my room, and he had a little Gideon's Bible. It was trying to share scripture with me. Blair was involved in a student ministry that was really encouraging people to share. And I remember saying, I don't want that. I was a hard-hearted little kid. And I remember taking this little Gideon's Bible and throwing it at Blair. 10-year-old little kid. Hard-hearted, dark little kid. I was far from God. I didn't want God. And God started moving. God started knocking on my heart. God started creating this desire to know him, this desire that I had a need, that I needed to be forgiven of my sin. I needed to be right with God. I felt guilty. I felt dirty. I felt empty. I felt this void, even as a little kid, pre-seventh grade kid. God, why do I feel this way? God started putting people in my life, putting stories and instances in my life, drawing me to him. Later on, I responded, I said, God, I want to know you. I want to be a follower of Christ. For you, some of y'all are in that process. Some of you are going, man, I feel like God's calling me. I feel like God's drawing me. I feel like I need to say bye to my old life. I need to leave my city of Ur that's full of the dark things, the things that don't honor God. But I need to follow God. And God's going to say this to you. I'm not going to give you the whole plan yet. I'm going to call you to a land you don't know like Abraham. But if you follow me, I'll bless you. That number 7 is important. It's complete. God promised Abraham 7 blessings. But for us, they're all through this person of Christ. One story we're doing. When I was in high school, went snow skiing. And we had seen all these signs for, and this is not a joke, the National Blind Skiers Association of America. And I saw them, and I thought, oh, this is not very PC. I really thought it was a joke. Like, blind snow skiers? Okay. Yeah, that's okay. And so I'm on a ski lift, and the top of this mountain, if you go straight down the middle, it was a double black diamond. Anybody know about double black diamonds? It's where you go die, basically. It's really bad. It's the toughest on a course. This is Colorado. So it's like, there's like boulders and like 15-foot drops and all this crazy stuff. But to the right and left, there are these more tame slopes. And so you'd go to the top, and we'd always go stand on the edge and watch people like get close to death on the double blacks. They'd roll, and skis would fly off, and like, I lost my toboggan, you know, all this crazy stuff. And then we'd go on the little tame slopes. And so I'm up there, and the ski lift stops. Now, the whole thing's on one cable, so if a kid falls at getting on the lift at the bottom, the whole thing stops. And it was pretty normal. We're sitting there in the cold, rocking, and I see a guy come to the top of the edge that was wearing a completely orange top. And I'm like, that's kind of different. And then behind him is a guy dressed like in normal ski gear. And they start, and the guy in front's about 5 yards in front of him. And I'm hearing the guy in back yell, left, wedge, right, stop, slow, and all these commands. And it hits me. The dude in front's in the National Blind Skiers Association, or whatever. He's blind. He's going down a double black diamond, and the only thing he has to guide him is this dude's voice behind him. Now, I'm like, at that point, it's not funny anymore. I'm like, I'm about to witness a homicide. This is going to be illegal. I'm going to be called. They're going to be like, Colorado State Police are going to be like, did you see that? Yes, sir, I saw the accident. He didn't see it coming, but I saw it. It was horrible. I mean, and oddly entertaining, but horrible, mostly horrible. And this should be illegal. Whoever put this on should go to jail, you know, whatever. And I watched that dude, and it was amazing. The guy behind him would command, he would act. And there wasn't any like, are you sure? Really? Do you mean it? Could you say it again? I would imagine the blind dude was completely in tune or attuned to his guide's words. That's all he had, right? Stop, wedge. It literally is life and death. It's a matter of if you go left and he says go right, you die. Or go right and you go left. Or if you don't wedge or if you don't slide, whatever, you literally could die. You're going to go the wrong place. We're in a really perilous moment, and you got to listen to my voice. And I watched this beautiful dance between this guy calling it and the guy in front skiing, and I watched him go the whole slope and make it, and it was awesome. I'm sitting there, and I always kind of think about things, and God says, why in the world don't you listen to me that way? Why in the world do you go, oh, God, are you sure? Really? Do you want me to do it? And he's saying, it's way more important what I'm calling you to do than that guy on the skier. And yet you delay me and you put me off and you say, really? And we got all this proof of God's faithfulness. And I just want to ask you today, why in the world would anybody, when God calls, why would any of us just not say yes? For some of you, you're like, man, I'm still learning about this, and that's fine. But there are many of us who we have seen God move, right? Prayers have been answered. Peace has been given. You've had complete chaos, and you stop and go, God, I need you right now. And this overwhelming sense of peace comes on you. That's God. You pray for something to happen, and it happens. You've got tension. You feel like you can't get out of a hole, and you pray. And next thing you know, a week or two out, you're out of this really hard situation. We've got all the proof we need. If you're a person today that says, man, I don't have enough proof, you keep coming. We'll keep lovingly showing you God. For some of us, we know who he is. We know what he's like. I want to pray for us today, but I want you to close your eyes and bow your heads. If you're a person who has never initially trusted Christ, I want to pray a prayer with you. If you're willing to pray it, and it's a prayer where you would call on and ask Christ to forgive you initially. And here's what it says. It says, Jesus, you can pray with me in your own mind. Please forgive me for wronging you. Forgive me for trying to save myself. I lay the control of my life over to you. Help me to follow you. I need you to be the center of my life. Please give me strength to be a Christ follower. Help me to grow and be a part of your church. And if you did that, I would love for you to mark that card for us so we can follow up with you, get you a Bible, get you started reading, get you understanding. But more importantly, we just want you to, I want to pray for you so that God can seal that. So, Father, I pray right now for us in this room that anybody that maybe have prayed that prayer for the first time, where they confess their need, they confess their sin, They confess their doubt. And God, I pray for them that if they meant that, that you would seal that decision in their own heart. God, whether or not they've been to church 1,000 times or never once before, I pray that if this was their moment where they confessed all they needed to you, I pray you'd forgive them. I pray you'd receive them. And God, for the rest of us that maybe are already following you, I pray for us, God, you give us radical faith like Abraham, that believed you, that knew your promises, that didn't need the details, but just said, I will go if he asks me to go. Father, I pray you give us this faith. God, I pray you give us faith to patiently believe when things are tough. God, I pray you give us faith to believe you when you seem far off. God, I pray you give us faith to keep on praying even when we don't feel like our prayers are being answered. God, I pray you give us faith to keep on believing in you, keep on trusting you from what you've already done. So Lord, I pray you just let us sing back to you what you're already doing in our hearts during this song. And I pray in Jesus' name.
You.